First of all, I would like to thank the Klaus Tschira Foundation and Klaus Tschira personally, and also HITS. As Professor Reuter just said, I'm a regular visitor of HITS since many years, actually since 2010, working mainly with Professor Springel in the theoretical astrophysics group. And as you heard, I originally come from Germany and I did my PhD in Munich, and I also studied a few years in Karlsruhe. Back then it was still the University of Karlsruhe. And I then went to the US mainly for career reasons, and I hope this will change soon so that young researchers in Germany can actually stay in Germany and do not have to go to the US or other countries. So the topic I will talk about is simulating the universe. So the idea here is that we try to understand how structures and galaxies form in the universe. So this is a very complex topic, and Professor Springel here at HITS is actually one of the world leaders in the subject, and we have worked together for many years on this. And what I will try to do in this talk, I want to show you first what we try to do, so what we really try to simulate, and then what we recently achieved in these kind of simulations. And this field is closely connected, is connected to mathematics, to physics, theoretical physics, astrophysics, and computation. And so I think it's actually an ideal topic for HITS itself to try and work on different frontiers. So before I start, I just want to give you a brief overview of what we know about the universe, some general remarks. So I start with our place home, which is actually the Milky Way. So if you look at the sky and you are outside of Heidelberg on the countryside somewhere, and you have a dark sky, you can actually see plenty of stars. And essentially all these stars belong to the Milky Way, so the galaxy is the galaxy where the sun and the earth belong to. And if it's very, very dark and you're very far away from Big City, you can actually see the stripe of the Milky Way also. This is if you look at a spiral arm of the Milky Way galaxy. So the Milky Way is a disc-like galaxy, and it has a lot of spiral arms. And one of these spiral arms can actually be seen on the sky if it's very dark. And all these are actually stars. So there are billions of stars in the Milky Way. But the Milky Way is not the only galaxy. So our neighbor is actually the Andromeda galaxy. This is a galaxy which looks very similar to the Milky Way. So if we could see our galaxy from outside, it would look very much like this Andromeda galaxy. This is a couple of million light years away from the Milky Way. And you can also see that this is a disc-like spiral structure, so it's pretty flat and it's like a disc, essentially. The universe contains many, many more galaxies. So each galaxy contains billions of stars, but there are billions and billions of galaxies actually in the visible universe. But interestingly, all these galaxies come mainly in two types, which makes it rather simple. They either come in this disc-like pattern, so which looks like the Milky Way, or they look like so-called elliptical galaxies. So these are galaxies which are more spherical, so more like a ball. So there the stars have a very different distribution. And interestingly, if you look at the universe in detail, you find mainly these types of galaxies. And now one question is that we try to understand how these galaxies actually form. So what gives them the shape, what gives them their color, and how do they evolve as a function of time, and so on. So this is what we try to understand using computer models. And it's not only the computer models that help us to understand these problems, it's also great, great advances in the observatories that we have. So there are a lot of ground-based telescopes and a lot of space-based telescopes. So this is, for example, the very famous Hubble Space Telescope. And Hubble is actually also celebrating an anniversary this year, so it's 25 years old, so it was launched in 1990. And it's pretty old now, but it still gives us extremely interesting results, which are scientifically highly relevant. And Hubble has the advantage that it's out in space, so it can observe galaxies much better because it does not have to see through the atmosphere of the Earth. You can do many things with a Hubble Space Telescope, so you can look at individual galaxies in great detail, you can look at many other objects. And one thing that you can also do, which might sound a bit stupid, you can actually point the space telescope to a very black spot on the sky, a spot which has about this size compared to the moon. And although you do not see anything by eye on this spot, if you take the Hubble Space Telescope, because it's so extremely powerful, and you let it collect or make a very long exposure over a couple of months, you'll actually see something very interesting. Instead of this dark region, you actually see something like this. So this is a picture of the Hubble Space Telescope with a very long exposure of a couple of months. And this is the so-called Hubble Ultra Deep Field. So this is one of the deepest images ever taken of space. And all these points that you actually see are not stars. So each point here is actually an individual galaxy. So each point are billions of stars that you can see. And what you can see here is that you see, first of all, different colors. So some of those are more orange, others are blue, and you can also see that they have different sizes. And the interesting thing about this picture is that it's not only a picture of galaxies, but it's also kind of a time machine, because some galaxies here are billions of light years away, and the light needs billions of years to reach us. So you see the galaxies actually shortly after the Big Bang. And such an image, which was, and there are many of these images, such an image allows us essentially to understand or to get an idea how galaxies evolved from very early times shortly after the Big Bang until today. And we try to build models to actually capture this process starting from the Big Bang to today to understand how galaxies grow. And this is kind of the observational data that we have and that our models have to describe if we have correct theory. And the theory that we have at the moment, or the picture of the evolution of the universe, and I guess most of you are familiar with this, is the basic idea that we have a Big Bang, which happened about 13.7 billion years ago. So we are essentially here now, so time is running from the left to the right, and at the beginning there was this Big Bang. And briefly after the Big Bang, there was a so-called inflationary phase, where the universe expanded extremely rapidly. And since then, the universe kept expanding. And as a function of time, you see that various things happened. So first, the first stars formed about 400 million years after the Big Bang. Then the first galaxies formed a billion years after the Big Bang. And the Earth is actually a rather recent thing here. The solar system just formed 5 billion years ago. And as I said, what we try to do, we try to understand this whole process. By using astrophysical models and supercomputer simulations. And you can also see that we have here satellites. So as I said before, this Hubble image can actually look back in time. And we can actually look back with satellites also back to this time of the so-called cosmic microwave microwave background. So this is something that happened 400,000 years after the Big Bang, and we can use satellites to observe this. And if you observe this, you see a picture like that. So this is what we also call the afterglow of the Big Bang. So this is an all-sky image taken from a satellite, which is far away from the Earth, which was launched 10 or 15 years ago. And this satellite took that picture. And what you see here is these red and blue spots. They correspond to density fluctuations in the early universe, just 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And it's these density fluctuations that led to all the galaxies that we observe today. So the Earth, the Milky Way, the Andromeda galaxy, all the other galaxies, they all formed out of this. So actually, we are kind of all encoded in this picture here. And the question is then, can we take this picture and evolve this forward in time to get galaxies as we observe them today? So that's the big challenge. And another thing that we need to do this is actually we have to understand what is the composition of the universe. And again, over the last 10 years, we learned an enormous amount of this. And the composition of the universe is actually very strange, because if you look in the cosmos and if you look on the sky, you see all these stars and the galaxies. But everything you see, everything on Earth, all the material we are made of, only makes up about 5% of the total content of the universe. So the other 95% are completely unknown, so we don't know what this is, but we know for sure that it exists. So there's one component which is so-called dark energy, which is a very mysterious form of energy which you find throughout the cosmos. And then there's another component, this 25%, which is called dark matter. So this is a matter component that we also don't know yet. So it's not atoms or electrons or protons, it's something completely unknown and we have more or less no idea what it is at the moment. And so it's these 95% plus the 5% which make the total content of the universe. But it's important to remember that we, the Earth and the stars, we are only a tiny, tiny contribution. It's actually like the tip of the iceberg that what the Earth and the solar system and the stars made up. So we have pretty good evidence for this, and we also know the initial conditions, and then you can ask the questions, well, if we know the initial conditions and if we know the laws of nature, there should be some way to go from these initial conditions to the real universe or to a virtual universe, which should actually look like our universe. So the initial conditions are given by this cosmic microwave background that I just showed you before. Then we know the composition of the universe, so it's dark matter, dark energy, and atoms. And we know the laws of nature, so we know general relativity from Einstein and many other theories. So we should be able to take this and evolve this forward in time to get a universe which just looks like our universe. So that's the main challenge that we try to face in these kind of research that we do. And unfortunately, these calculations are very expensive and very demanding. And so you cannot do this with pen and paper, and you can also not do this with ordinary computers. So what you really need is national supercomputer facilities. And I just show a few examples here. So these are some computers in the US, for example, in Texas and Tennessee. This is a very powerful supercomputer in France. And since I'm speaking Germany, I especially want to point out two machines, very powerful machines in Germany. So this is the Hornet supercomputer in Stuttgart that recently came online, actually last year, end of last year. And this is the SuperMUC in Germany from the Leibniz Rechenzentrum, which is also extremely powerful. And since I'm now kind of a foreign speaker here, I would like to point out that the supercomputing situation in Germany is actually at the moment really good compared to the US. And I can only emphasize that Germany should stay on this track, because the US is actually kind of having a very hard time at the moment giving enough allocations to researchers to do their research. And the situation at the moment is much better in Germany. And so I think this is an important thing, and Germany should make sure that it stays like that, or maybe even gets better. So if you take these computers and put all the equations on the computer, you can then calculate the evolution of the universe. And this is what we mainly do. And you can, for example, also study dark matter. And what I will show you now is a computer simulation that was done by Volker Springel. And this computer simulation will show you the distribution of dark matter around the Milky Way galaxy. So the Milky Way galaxy itself is supposed to be surrounded by a huge sphere of dark matter. And what this simulation will actually show, will show you the time evolution and the distribution of this dark matter. And the reason why this is important is that we are actually actively searching for dark matter, and the only way to make predictions about dark matter is by running these simulations. So we have no other possibility to understand the structure, the distribution of dark matter, except these kind of supercomputer simulations. So this is the simulation, so it will soon get a bit brighter, the movie. So what you see here is a time counter in the upper right. So this is counting the time since the Big Bang in billion years. So we are now 100 million years after the Big Bang. And what you see here color-coded is actually dark matter. So in the real universe, we cannot see this, but with computer simulations, we can actually see this and we can visualize this. And the brighter the color, the higher the density of the dark matter. And the length scale that you see here is a couple of hundreds of thousands of light years. So these are is a very large region here around the galaxy. And the Milky Way galaxy is supposed to form at the center of this image, of this movie. And what you can see is actually that the distribution of dark matter is rather complicated. So you see a lot of filaments and you see a lot of overdensities, these little dots here, these are dark matter concentrations, but eventually they all collapse in this central object. And this is actually where the Milky Way galaxy forms. And all the other little dots that you see, they will also host galaxies. And all these galaxies will essentially merge with the Milky Way galaxies to build the Milky Way galaxy as we observe it today. And so we are now already 3 billion years after the Big Bang, and you can see that this process continues, and you can also see that the structure grows and grows. So there's more and more dark matter. And at the end, you will have so much dark matter in this central object, something like a million times a million suns. So that's the mass of this dark matter halo. So it's enormously massive, and it hosts at the center the Milky Way galaxy. And also at this point, you can again see that the structure is very lumpy. So it's a very complicated structure. And you can only understand this with these kind of super computations that are actually done here at HITS, for example. So this movie will run until a time of 13 billion years, which is kind of the age of the universe. The only problem with this calculation is that this calculation shows you only the distribution of dark matter. So all this color coding is just dark matter and dark energy. But it doesn't include any stars or any galaxies or anything that we actually see on the sky. So if you want to confront the model to observations, you have to include the stars and the galaxies as well. And unfortunately, this is a much more complicated problem because the processes that form actually the galaxies are much more difficult to model than these dark matter physics. But you need to do this to actually see the galaxies and to compare to observations. So this is just an illustration. So in the background, you see the dark matter distribution, and in the center, you see a galaxy that I just put by hand there. So we want to see also this in the simulation. But at the moment, or in this movie that I just showed, we just showed this large dark matter distribution and not the stars. Now, to include the stars, you have to do much more work. And We have actually done this together with Volker Springel here at HITS and a couple of other researchers at MIT, Harvard, and Princeton in the US, and also in Cambridge in the United Kingdom. So we have run a simulation which is called the Lustrous simulation, and this simulation is at the moment the largest cosmological simulation that was ever done. It includes dark matter, dark energy, stars, galaxies, so everything we know, so in one big simulation. And so this was a very big effort, and it required multiple supercomputers, and I would like to point out that the main calculation was actually done here in Germany on the supercomputer, and a large fraction was also done in France at the Curie machine, and some small contribution also came from the Stampede supercomputer in the US. And the big advantage of this simulation is that it really includes now everything. So you see, for example, here in the background, where it's written dark matter density, so this is all dark matter. But then this picture that you see here is actually a galaxy, which was also formed in the simulation. And that's the big advantage, that it also contains these information about the galaxies. The problem with the simulation is, as I said, it's extremely expensive, so you need even more computing time. And we got the computing time actually through various consortia. So there's in the US the so-called Exceed program, where researchers can apply to get a lot of computing time. In Europe, we have something similar, which is called the PRAISE program. And as I mentioned, the Leibniz Rechenzentrum played a very crucial role for this simulation. We actually finished most of the calculation on machines of the Leibniz Rechenzentrum. Now, if you publish these results, you also get an enormous feedback from the media, and the public interest is enormous. So we published these results actually in May 2014. And the estimated outreach of the press release, so the number of people essentially that read about the work, is something like 500 million people. And the reason is that we were actually on the front page of the BBC and also the New York Times with this simulation, because it's really the first simulation that can actually describe the stars, the galaxies, and dark matter at the same time with a very high level of detail, and that was not possible before. So this tells you also something that this research is really very close to the people and to the public, because many people actually care about these things. So they really want to know how the universe works, where the galaxies come from, and so for us, this is a kind of also an additional motivation to explain this to the public, and we really pay attention to this, and I think these kind of outreach articles really make this clear that we work hard to make the science also understandable. So now I want to show you a few movies and a few pictures of this simulation that I just mentioned, to just give you an idea how good this simulation is. And I want to convince you that this simulation is now so good that you can actually not distinguish it anymore from the real universe. So if I show you a picture of this simulation and a picture of the real universe, you will not be able to tell the difference anymore. So this is the level of detail that we reached. And before I do this, I just want to give you an overview of the size of the simulation. So what you see here is a rotation of the volume of the simulation, where I show on the left dark matter and the rest on the right, I show the gas, so the stuff that is essentially forms stars. So here in the dark matter, you see again this very clumpy and filamentary structure that I mentioned before. And on the right, you see the temperature field of the gas. And again, the main advantage of this simulation is that it includes the gas and the dark matter at the same time, which is very difficult to do and very demanding from a computational point of view. And the volume that we simulate in this simulation is a cube, which has a site length of something like 350 million light years. So it's a really, really large fraction of the universe. And it's large enough to capture all the properties of galaxies. And this was also not possible before. Now, if you look in detail at the galaxies that form in this simulation, you can see something like this. So all these galaxies are not real galaxies, but they are all simulated galaxies. So you can again see these elliptical galaxies that I mentioned in the beginning, but you can also see disk galaxies. So here are these typical disk galaxies in different types, and also something like irregular galaxies. And if you look at these galaxies in detail and analyze them and compare them to their real counterpart, you will actually not be able to tell the difference. So they really look like our galaxies. And if I would have given this talk 3 or 4 years ago with simulations available at that time, the galaxies would have looked completely different. So you would immediately be able to tell the difference. And the main reason why we get this agreement is actually that we have an enormously better understanding of the physics at play, of the astrophysics. And also the numerical methods that we use are much better than many years ago. And especially here at HITS, Volker Springel developed a special numerical scheme that we actually used for this simulation. And this scheme actually led to this breakthrough that we can actually make these galaxies. And that was essentially developed at HITS, so that's the main contribution here. And a third reason why this is possible is that we have now the supercomputers to actually do this. These supercomputers were also not available 5 years ago. So these are all state-of-the-art supercomputers, and you can only do this with those. To give you another idea of the strength of this simulation, I want to show you another movie which shows you the dynamic range. So what we do here is we actually zoom in into the simulation, and we start with the dark matter distribution on a scale of hundreds of millions of light years, and now we will zoom in onto an individual galaxy. And the thing that you should appreciate here is actually the fact that the simulation has an enormous dynamic range. So we can resolve scales which are something like a couple of light years to millions of light years. So there's a factor of 1 million in the dynamic range that we actually have to resolve here. And now as we keep on zooming in, at some point the movie will switch to the stars. So this is actually not dark matter anymore, but this is stars. And you can see that an individual galaxy shows up here, which forms at the center of these dark matter overdensities. And this galaxy looks very similar to a galaxy like the Milky Way galaxy. And this is also only the first time that we actually can do this, again using this new scheme that was developed here. And now as we zoom out, you can again see the enormous dynamic range, and at some point we will see the dark matter distribution again with all its complicated structure. So this happens now. So again, this is really a major breakthrough that we achieved here. And to really convince you that this virtual universe looks just like our universe, I want to show you this picture here. So these are two Hubble deep fields, essentially. One is real and the other one is fake. Fake in the sense that it was taken from the simulation. And if you just look at it by eye, it's essentially kind of impossible to tell which one is the real one and which one is the virtual one. So in a statistical sense, these are indistinguishable. And well, we know, of course, which is the real one. So the left one is the real one, the right one is the virtual one. But if you look at the detailed statistical properties of these simulations, you cannot tell the difference anymore. So what this means, we can now really, in a computer, create a universe which just looks like our universe. Okay, before I come to my conclusions, I also want to give an outlook, because I was now talking mainly about this one simulation that we did, but we plan already, together with HITS and Volker Springel and other researchers in the US, we plan already a much bigger simulation. So this is what we call the Illustris +++ simulation, and this, in some sense, will be the ultimate simulation of our universe, because it will cover a much larger fraction of the universe. So the cube that I just showed you before will be much larger. It will be 8 times larger in volume. And the computing resources that we need are enormous. So I guess most of you will not be familiar with these numbers, but 100 million CPUs is a very large fraction of computing time on national supercomputers. And this simulation will be carried out on 30,000 computers at the same time. And again, HITS is heavily involved in this, because to run actually such a program on so many computers in parallel, this is a very challenging task to parallelize this. And again, Volker Springel is one of the world leaders to actually make these codes parallel. So without this, you cannot do anything with these simulations. And again, there's a strong German involvement here, because we actually got these 100 million CPU hours at the computing center in Stuttgart on this new Hornet supercomputer. And just to give you an idea, we applied also in the US for this time, and we got in the US 5 million, whereas we got in Germany 100 million. So this tells you already that the situation in supercomputing is at the moment really much better in Germany compared to the US. Okay, let me conclude at that point. So the main point that I want to give you is that I think these kind of cosmological simulations are now crucial and are the ideal tool actually to study the formation of galaxies and structures in the universe. So there's no other way to do these calculations. And HITS is very much involved in all these kind of applications of computing and science and so on, and I think that this is actually a very important thing which goes much beyond this pen and paper approach. So I think the combination of physics, applied mathematics, computer science, and all this together with supercomputing will lead, or has led already, into very deep insights of very complex phenomena which you cannot track with a simple analytic calculation. And I think this will become in the future even more important, and I think here HITS will play a crucial role actually to push this forward in the future. Okay, thanks.